video in a while, and I figured since I'm filming this in the depths of my basement, why not focus on another H.G. Wells classic film? This time, the 1960 George Pal classic, The Time Machine. Can this film live up to the classic novel? We're going to find out. I'm Bob, you're you, and this is Classically Bad Cinema. H.G. Wells' novel, The Time Machine, was one of the first science fiction novels ever to be published and is largely credited with popularizing the concept of time travel by usage of a vehicle or a time machine, a term coined in the novel and obviously still used to this day. It was one of the first early examples of the dying Earth genre. The portion of the novel sees a time traveler in a distant future where the sun is huge and red and also places the time machine within the realm of eschatology. That is, the study of the end times, the end of the world, and ultimately the destiny of humankind. The Time Machine has been adapted many times since its publishing in the form of movies, TV shows, comic books, and musicals. The movie starts on January 5th, 1900, at a dinner party at the London home of inventor George Wells, played by actor Rod Taylor, who obviously is not there. In the novel, we're never given the name of the main character. He's just known as the Time Traveler. Anyways, the guests start to get impatient, and I mean really impatient, to the point of really getting pissed off. I mean, that's fine, F them. Even if it was some tragedy might have befallen him, your fat ass having a meal is obviously more important here.
Now let's cut this stupid cake, because I know the fat guy's going to have a heart attack if we don't eat again soon.
He arrives suddenly and in pretty rough shape and exhausted, which either he has been through one hell of a fight for survival, or he's had one hell of a time at whatever New Year's Eve party he attended 5 days earlier. His guests desperately want an explanation. George takes a huge swig of booze as he begins to recount his adventures since the last time they met on New Year's Eve 1899.
Because stories like he's about to tell, 9 times out of 10, probably started with alcohol in the first place.
We flashback days earlier to New Year's Eve at the turn of the century at George's house, where he unveils his invention he has been tirelessly working on. He clues his guests in that the invention deals with time. They, of course, automatically assume it's a clock.
Oh, I've always maintained what this nation needs is a reliable timepiece. Navy needs one. Army needs one. For the artillery, you know.
Well, you couldn't do better, George. So that's why you've been in hiding, eh?
Really? That's your guess? Your friend has been MIA for weeks, and you think the thing that he's been working on is a clock? Well, he either must be a really bad inventor, or he must have invented one hell of a clock. George unveils a small model and explains it's a small-scale model of a time machine that he has invented. This obviously isn't nearly as cool or sexy as an 82 DeLorean. And I can understand why Doc figured if you're going to invent a time machine, you need to do it with a little style. He utilizes the car to simulate the time traveler, again a nod to the novel itself. He then uses his friend's finger to move the tiny lever.
Get that finger out of your ear. You don't know where that finger's been.
And the device disappears as it travels into the future, or so he claims. It's at this moment where we get to see just what great friends George has. I mean, even with the model disappearing in front of them, they remain very doubtful. And they also are very critical. I mean, F the fact that this guy just potentially discovered time travel. And not only are they critical, but they also come off as kind of hostile, too. They nitpick the hell out of him here. Fingerboy here can't get past the fact that he can't see the model. George tried to explain to him that it's in the future. But again, Fingerboy questions since the model is occupying the same space, he should be able to see it. George, who really should use another finger for this guy, argues that time changes space. Well, if he isn't going to use that finger, then he really should use this. The real question becomes for George, contraption, as they call it, or what are the financial ramifications of an invention? What's it worth, and who's willing to buy it? I think we all have that one asshole friend that does nothing else but suck the joy out of our life, like they're some sort of psychic vampire. Anyways, this nonsense continues a while longer until they get bored and decide to leave so they can ring in the new year. George probably wishes he just invented that damn clock right about now.
George goes back into the house feeling completely defeated, just trying to figure out what the hell just happened. Fortunately, he finds his friend Philby, that's played by actor Alan Young. Alan would famously go on to play Wilbur Post on the TV show Mr. Ed, and also did the voice of Scrooge McDuck on Disney's cartoon DuckTales. And he would stay relatively busy until his death in 2016 at the age of 96. Anyways, Philby questioned George's real motives and his preoccupation with time, knowing full well it has nothing to do with any commercial venture. Well, George finally relents and said he's tired of the time he's been born into. I mean, the fact that men aren't dying fast enough these days, they're using science to find more efficient ways to depopulate the Earth. Philby deplores George that if his invention can do as he says it can, to destroy it, fearing that if he doesn't, it could end up destroying him. After a brief heated exchange, George senses his friend's true, genuine concern for him and makes sure not to leave him bad term, invites him over to his home for dinner again after the holiday. Of course, George has the ability to not only bend time and space, but also to bend the truth, knowing full well that he's going to be using his time machine later. No sooner does Philby leave and George goes right into his labs and prepares his time machine for an adventure into the future. The next sequences is where this movie really shines, as we get that Academy Award-winning special effects by Gene Warren and Tim Barr for their use for time-lapse photographic effects, which show the world changing rapidly with the time-traveling journey into the future. It famously utilizes a mannequin from a department store next door that would eventually be utilized again in the 2002 Time Machine remake. After initial tests of his machine, just to make sure that he doesn't disintegrate himself or somehow create a black hole that could completely doom mankind as we know it, George stops in the year 1917 just to check things out after his lab windows are boarded up. George walks from his yard in California to what I guess is supposed to be London. Funny part is you can really see where the two are put together here. These landscape shots are really the only special effects that don't look particularly good in this movie. For my research, I found that the movie had a budget of just under $1 million, so they couldn't obviously shoot on location in London. So the live-action sequences were filmed from the end of May through June of 1959 in Culver City, California, with the backgrounds often filled in by virtue of matte painting and models. Anyways, it's here where he meets up with whom he assumes is his friend David Philby, but it turns out to be his son James. See, we got to understand that this was part of cinematic history where everyone's future or past family members ended up looking exactly like them. He learns that not only is there currently a war being waged in Europe, but his good friend David had been killed the year before. George also learns from James that his father wouldn't sell George's home, believing that one day he would return. After all the press he knew, George returns to the lab and decides to travel farther into the future. He pauses briefly after seeing warplanes in the air and realizes the world is in the midst of yet another war, making it look like his attempt to find a more peaceful time a complete failure, much like Ray and Professor Forrester's attempt to keep their vehicles in War of the Worlds. He also gets another nice surprise when his home goes up in flames, ironically much like Ray's house did in War of the Worlds as well. He ultimately stops after hearing what turns out to be air sirens. Panicked crowds run past him as people scramble to the bomb shelter. George is confused but also amazed at the technological advances he sees when he runs into James Philby yet again. Man, what are the odds of that happening at the same place 30-something years into the future? Small world, I guess. The quiet-aged son of David Philby is shocked when he realizes who he's talking to, seeing how George hasn't aged a day in all these years. I'm surprised that the topic of George and time travel never came up between David and his son James. You'd think he might have mentioned it when he was explaining why he wouldn't liquidate George's home for all those years. The shock is short-lived when a second siren blows, indicating that the nuclear satellite is locked onto its target and warns George to get below before the mushrooms start sprouting, and wait there until all clear. This, of course, is going to play a role later on in the film when he meets up with the Eloi. Moment later, the bomb explodes. George is thrown to the ground as the city and humanity are destroyed. Now, you may be asking, if the blast had enough power and heat to destroy the city, the cars, and everything else around him, shouldn't he have been instantly vaporized or at the least been blinded by the initial blast itself? My eyes! Or what about the radiation sickness? Wouldn't that have killed him? I mean, I get it. You know, just keep in mind that not only was this made during a time when everyone believed at worst you'd just be mutated into a monster, or maybe you'd be given superhuman powers or something. But also keep this in mind. It's just the show. I should really just relax. The other issue I can't help but wonder is why the EMP from the bomb didn't fry his time machine. It must be made from the same material as this guy's camera from War of the Worlds. After all, the EMP had no effect on that one either. Again, I guess it's just something we have to go with. So not only does this lucky bastard somehow survive the blast and the destruction...
Well, some might call it luck. I'd like to call it... well, luck, I guess. So what?
But he also miraculously survives a nearby volcano that blows, sending out advanced killer lava into London as well. Which is strange considering there are no active volcanoes in the UK and the British Isles. Plus, they are nowhere near a tectonic plate. I myself am leaning towards it not being actual lava, but being a really pissed off variant of the blob or something. That would explain why the lava slowly comes into the city until it evidently sees George, and it goes into full kill mode after him, covering him like a giant tidal wave. Not quite. Luckily, it kicks the time machine into high gear before being encased in solid lava. Evidently, the DeLorean isn't the only time machine when kicked into high speed, you get to see some serious shit. Also, why the hell is this guy using a match to see the dial? That damn thing is well backlit. Did his retina get fried in the blast? Now that would have made sense. Eventually, after only a mere 790,000 years, George is freed from his rock-like tomb as the lava wears away, revealing a lush, unspoiled landscape. George makes the mistake of stopping the time machine too quickly and is not only thrown off of it, but manages to roll the time machine in the process, being the first human ever to be thrown from a machine that doesn't actually move an inch. And after life or karma pisses or whatever the hell that is on him, which I never know quite what it is, he awakes outside a large sphinx. He then starts to make his way for the lovely painting of the happy little dome that he had seen built before rolling his time machine. You know, the one that sits perfectly still, on no wheels, the one that he rolled, somehow. He quickly discovers that it's under disrepair and completely empty, yet cutely decorated. He sets off to explore more and see if he can find any sort of humans on what is seeming like an empty world. And after finally enduring music that gets more and more intense, he finds people hanging out by the river with seemingly no care in the world, like a teenage Instagram influencer or something. One woman who's carried off by the current screams for help, but her companions show absolutely no concern whatsoever. Again, like some disgruntled teenager that cares for nothing.
No, I don't believe in nothing no more!
George ends up rescuing her and doesn't even get a thank you. George ends up following him to the dome where he talks to Weena. She oddly gets nervous as the stunt starts to set and drags George into the dome. It's here where George learns that there's no government, no people to set laws, and they have absolutely no idea where the food and clothes come from. We find out Weena and her people are the Eloi. They do not operate machines, they don't work, they don't read, and they know little of history. One of them takes George to the library where he tries to read a book, but it ends up just crumbling into dust in his hands. Outraged, he decides to leave in utter disgust. I mean, leave a woman to die in a river, that's one thing. But let a good piece of literature crumble to dust? Well, that's bullshit. After losing his mind and stomping off into the darkness of high noon, he discovers that his machine has been dragged into the closed sphinx. Man, karma really kicked him in the ass here. He walks away from his machine for a couple of hours and ends up getting stolen. It doesn't take George long to realize that he's not alone. He lights a match and the figure scurried away. Turns out Rena ends up following him, telling him the Morlocks, who only come out at night, are the ones responsible for taking his machines. They are the ones that provide the clothes they wear and the food they eat, and they have to obey their commands. It's interesting as she knew where everything came from, but the guy back at the dome didn't. A hideous Morlock jumps out and tries to drag Rena away. And the funny thing is, if you look closely, you can see the actor forgot to put his Morlock mask on before this shot. Oops. George saves her yet again, and it pretty much becomes a habit at this point, and decides to make a fire to keep the Morlocks away. She takes him to the ancient museum where the talking ring tells of a war in the distant past between the East and the West that lasted 326 years. Turns out the atmosphere became so contaminated that it could no longer be safely breathed, and that the fighting only stopped because there was nothing left to fight with and fewer people left to fight. Damn, that's some persistence, isn't it? Almost as persistent as these two alien knuckleheads from the classic episode of Star Trek. Another ring describes humanity's struggle for survival, Many decided to move underground and start a new way of life, while some returned to the surface. George realized that this was the beginning of speciation that resulted in two separate species on Earth, the Morlocks and the Eloi. And by some twist of fate, Eloi became servants, whom the Morlocks bred and raised like cattle, only to bring them to the cavern when they got old enough, which explains why he hasn't seen any older people. George and Weena return to the air shaft, and he starts to climb down to retrieve his machine, but stops when the sirens emerge and blare from the Sphinx. Weena, along with the other Eloi, are now in a trance-like state and head for the open doors at the base. The sirens stop and the doors close, trapping Weena and the others inside.
Missed it by that much.
Once the siren quits, the Eloi snap out of their trance, and George is left to wonder what the hell was that. One of the Eloi repeats the all-clear comment that James Philby said before the bomb exploded. Confused and upset, he tries telling them there's no more flying machines, there's no more bombs, and it was ages ago where men were told to go below the ground to avoid the raining death. He is merely told that is what the rings have said. But as George points out, obviously they didn't listen, and they sure in the hell didn't learn anything. He is further enraged when he asks about those that went below, who's going to help them. And he is told that
they never come back. Nobody can bring them back.
Refusing to believe that, George decides to take matters in his own hands.
Yeah, a lot of people are doing that these days.
And goes off to the air shaft to rescue Weena and the others by himself. Now I have to ask, and this is for a friend. Now it's the future. It's been through over 326 years of war at this point. What about advanced future weapons?
Wait a minute. This is the future. Where are all the phaser guns?
No, not going to go back. Not going to look at the museum. Just going to go down there unarmed. Yeah, you're right. That's probably for the best. He descends into the cavern and makes a torch right away because he isn't here to make friends.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Slowly making his way into the cavern, he makes a disturbing, and I gotta say, somewhat comical discovery. It's disturbing when he discovers that the Morlocks are in fact cannibalistic and have been breeding the Eloi to use as food. I guess Eloi, the other white meat. The comical part is the fact that we have full skeletons lying around. Not bones here and there, but actual full skeletons of Eloi victims. I have to say, the remake did a better job with this scene, both visually as well as the actor's reaction to this discovery. George makes his way to the main cavern room where he's being stalked by ninja-like Morlocks. He finds the Eloi and Weena being led through the caves and quickly grabs her, and another Eloi follows, as he has to fight off Morlocks and their whips. Yeah, I bet you wish you would have looked around for that old museum now for one of those cool weapons, huh? Pretty ironic that the man who had enough of the violence and warfare of his time is now forced to have to fight off a species of beings that is killing and devouring another. They are all cornered in a room in a cave when George quickly lights a match to force the attackers back. Because hey, if you establish an enemy's weakness earlier in a movie, then damn it, you better use it. He grabs his torch and luckily gets it lit and goes into full ass-whoop mode and just start laying waste to the Morlocks. Again, for a guy that was totally tired of war and killing, he sure is kicking a whole lot of ass here. I guess it must be the kidnapping his woman and hitting him with a whip that's really got him pissed.
But FYI, I beat wholesale ass for a lot less than that.
George unfortunately starts to get overpowered due to the sheer number of Morlocks there are. Just kidding again. Actually, another Eloi jumps in, Leroy Jenkins style.
Do this, Leroy Jenkins!
And him and George give the Morlock the 1-2 punch.
Down goes Frazier!
That causes other Eloi to get involved in the fight as well and allowing them to escape. They make their way through the air vent as George lights the caverns on fire. Once they get to the surface, everyone starts throwing down wood down the shaft to keep the fires burning to destroy the Morlocks. And destroy them they did. Holy shit.
Boy, that escalated quickly.
George and Weena sit by the river as George ponders life now when the others come up to show him that the door to the Sphinx is open, revealing his machine. He's run in calling for Weena to follow, only to have the door closed right before she's able to enter.
Missed it by that much.
Leaving him trapped in the Sphinx with some pretty pissed off Morlocks. After fighting him off, George speeds into the future before switching the lever and returning to his own time. Careful there, George. You don't want to roll that damn thing again. Thus, the movie coming full circle to where we started at the beginning. You know, back to the asshole friends that continually doubt everything he has to say, even when asking, seriously, where have you been? I mean, look at this guy. What the hell do you think happened to him?
I'm kicking my ass, do you mind?
He raises the bar when he remembers the flower in his pocket that Weena gave him and asks Philby to identify it if he can, which of course he isn't, prompting everyone to decide to leave. As everyone leaves, Yor says bye to Philby and thanks him for being a friend, always. Now some of you may ask, if he knows Philby's going to be killed in battle, why doesn't he try to warn him before he left? Well, it's interesting enough, in 1993 they made a documentary for this film. While most of the documentary focused on the director, George Powell, and the making of the movie props, there was a 15-minute segment where Rod Taylor and Alan Young reprise their roles as George and Philby. The scene takes place in George's house, with George coming back to try to prevent Philby from being killed in World War I. The documentary is included in some of the DVD versions of this film. Philby goes back in to talk to George, only to find out that he's dragged the machine back into his lab and has gone into the future. He theorizes George wouldn't have gone back empty-handed, and they try to figure out what he might have took with him. Turns out he took 3 books with him, allowing the audience to theorize which books he brought back with him. The end. And I mean it this time. This is really actually the end.
So what did I think of this 1960 classic? Well, it's time to go to the hits and misses.
Starting with the misses, and I gotta say the first thing is really, really bad friends. It's amazing how unsupporting his friends are, except for Philby, at his breakthrough. I get being skeptical at the idea, but after the model disappears, you think they come around a little bit. I mean, unless George was some complete liar, I think they would give him the benefit of the doubt. And it's worse when he returns from the future, and they still refuse to believe him. He's obviously been in one hell of a fight for survival here. I like how he gave Philby the flower to look at, but how cool would it have been if George would have nabbed one of those talking rings, and when he started questioning him, spun it. That might have actually shut them up. The special effects, or at least 0.001%, you know, repeating, of course, of the special effects. Overall, the vast majority still look amazing 60 years later. And there is a reason this film won an Oscar for special effects. But a couple of times you can obviously see that the scene was added, you know, with the dark outline. But even with that, I mean, check this out. Check out these special effects from a film from the 1980s and compare it to this film made in the 1960s. Continuity. George is standing in a small park across from Philby's department store when the atomic bomb weapon detonates. The cars in the street are instantly turned into burning hulks. The buildings are crumbled and burst into flame. However, George, standing no more than 20 feet away from both, doesn't even seem to break a sweat. Very speedy lava. George barely gets out of the city in 1966 before the lava from a nearby volcano could cook him alive. In a short time it takes George to walk a few meters to the machine, a volcano explodes, and it reaches him. It's incredible, especially as I mentioned before, there's no active volcanoes in Britain. And when the lava approaches, it's moving very slowly as it flows along the ground like normal. But then it seems to flow at lightning speed as it reaches George and splashes around him like a tidal wave. That lava can either defy gravity or, again, it's a variant of the blob sent to destroy him. But like I said, this movie is a classic, so we gotta go to the hits. And the first thing on my list is the special effects. Like I said, this was a special effect marvel at the time, and the stop animation still holds up even today. It was a great way to show time travel from his point of view. Again, this was 1960, and this was 1980. And the story itself. The novel is one of my favorite books, and the movie transfers well to the big screen. It's definitely one of those incidents of be careful what you wish for. George despises the barbarism of his own time and desires a journey into the future where mankind no longer wages war. Sadly, he gets his wish after learning that the Eloi of 802,701 are peaceful to the point of indolence, possessing barely any sense of self-preservation whatsoever, and is forced to go to battle himself, something he despises in order to save them. It's almost a tragedy. The more that George travels into the future, the fiercer the war becomes, ultimately arriving on the day that World War III begins in 1966, a war that would last an astounding 326 years. But then it is also responsible for creating the world of 802,000, with Morlocks being the descendants of those who ended up in the air raid shelters, and Eloi being the ones who ended up staying above ground. And food for thought. The three books were a nice added touch at the end of the film. I love the idea that Philby asked Miss Watchett and ultimately the audience, which three books would you have taken in order to restart civilization? Which I'm sure led some good discussion with moviegoers back in the day.
So is this 1960 classic worth going to the depths of the earth and kicking some Morlock ass to save? Or should you just let them devour it?
By all means, whip some ass here, because this movie is worth the watch and really does the novel justice, and is one of the all-time best book adaptations ever. The story is great, the special effects are well done, and is chock full of action.
Well, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this film, hit that like and subscribe button below. If you didn't like it, then tell that annoying friend that keeps calling you a liar to hit that like and subscribe button below. But that's all I got. Until next time, I'm Bob, you're you. So long, everybody.